Animal Magnetism, exploring animal care for creatures great and small, conservation and preservation in today's world. Find out what a single voice can do to make a difference in the lives of animals. Animal Magnetism with Carolyn Hennesy starts right now on UVN Radio.
Good morning. Once again, listeners, preservationists, conservationists, and those of you truly attempting to cultivate the preservationist heart. And once again, I always have trouble with that term, one voice. Yeah, all right, it's my voice. But boy, I am surrounded by very vocal, extremely gorgeous, fabulously kind-hearted women today. And so it's not just my voice. It's never been just my voice. It never is just one voice. God bless Jack Hanna. We are so excited. We are just thrilled. And I think I speak for all of us. I think I speak for my co-host, Andrea Compton, my other co-host, mm-hmm. Camille Lacott.
Hello.
And myself, Carolyn Hennesy. Thank you so much for being with us. When I say we are thrilled today, because we have someone in studio with us who, let's say, vegan, yes, but I think raw foodie. That's the term you like, correct?
I prefer it.
Raw foodie. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, Karen Wallington is here. She comes all the way from Canada, and from Toronto. And why is she here? Because it is not necessarily a question of immediate rescue of an animal. What does SeaWorld do that Blackfish, sort of smeared? It's not necessarily to do with animals or a particular animal, but it's animals in general. And really in an indirect way, because you eat no animal products whatsoever in your diet, and you haven't for a while. So she's flown all the way here just to be with us.
Hey.
Not really, but we happen to be a stop on her way. And she's going to tell us all about being a raw foodie, being a vegan, if you can't go directly to raw foodie, and we're going to discuss how this is going to really save the animals and in turn save the planet. So welcome.
Thank you.
I'm going to tell everyone just a little bit about you. It's fascinating because you would never know this by looking at you, but you are one of the top dreadlock specialists in the world. And that's a niche. Mm-hmm. That is mm-hmm. a niche. You've carved out something fabulous for yourself. You are the founder of Techniques. I'm so desperate to have my hair dreadlocked now.
Do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I need to, Mama needs a job. Mama needs to act. I don't know how well they'd respond to that. You are the founder of Techniques to Use exclusively at the Not Just Dread Studio, as well as the Dread Quarters Salon in Vancouver, British Columbia, formerly known as the Naughty Boy Lock Shop. I thrill to that name. Dolly Lock Studio in St. Petersburg, Florida, and Sane Style,
yes,
in Stockholm, Sweden. You are the author of the Naughty Boy Dreadlock Manual, used for the Naughty Boy Loctician. Loctician. See, locks, dreadlocks, locks. Not loke. Yeah. The Naughty Boy Loctician Training and Education. I love it, that manual. Karen's dreading techniques make it possible to lock any length of, I see, and even with glasses on. I don't know why. I need my chaffee this morning. Karen's dreading techniques make it possible to lock any hair length or texture without the use of chemicals or products. She has an international clientele and has trained stylists in Canada, the United States, and Europe. In 2008, Karen was a top 10 finalist on Somebody take over for me. Seriously. Slice's Superstar Hair Challenge, produced and hosted by celebrity stylist Mark Anthony. Mm-hmm. So, we have you and we have hair. And I was even reading with my glasses. But you also happen to be a hardcore raw foodie. And since we deal with all things animal on this show, this has to include why we shouldn't be eating them and what steps to take towards that. So, first, I'm going to tell you the story, because you don't know how Karen and I met. This was kind of fascinating, and it's serendipitous. I never believe in coincidence. It's serendipitous. It's fate and kismet. We happen to be at a book signing for one of your friends.
That's right, Lisa Lattiser.
That's right, at Dark Delicacies, mm-hmm. which is a wonderful sort of horror, vamp, goth, cult shop on Magnolia Boulevard in Burbank. And you and I were just sort of watching her sign, and it happened to be the full moon, Black Alchemy full moon sale, so I was getting some of my fabulous perfumes from Black Alchemy Phoenix, Black Phoenix Alchemy Labs, and we looked at each other, and actually, first of all, you were wearing something that had no sleeves, and I was just standing talking to you, I would say for about 5 minutes before I looked at your arms, and I went, what that? What is that? And I don't know if the camera can get it, but you have white tattoos. They are so beautiful.
Oh,
they're so exquisitely beautiful. And if I think I might actually get a white tattoo and just not tell anyone. And y'all can try and find it. And I thought, I love this person. And then we decided that we were hungry. So we went next door to the now out of business, unfortunately.
Oh, no.
This is why we're here today. To keep that kind of thing from happening. It was a gluten-free market. And you went in for something. It was in the freezer case. It was a...
Coconut Bliss ice cream
in the many flavors, which I think they didn't have. I don't know. Anyway, I went in for gluten-free bread. It's an acquired taste. But then I thought, you've got to come on the show. You just have to come on the show and talk about why it's so important, not only for the animals, but for us as human beings. And when we decide we enjoy this type of diet, then we don't want to eat meat anymore. And so it's a continuous 360 circle. So there you go. Andrea, what do you got for?
Where'd you grow up, Karen?
Toronto, Canada.
Ah,
yes, the north.
So you were born there and you've stayed there, but you've traveled extensively.
Yeah, I do some traveling.
I'm eating a, what's it called? It's a freeze dried.
Freeze dried strawberry.
It's a
whole dried strawberry.
It's a whole dried. It's not freeze dried.
No,
sorry.
It's a whole dried strawberry. So y'all just take over. I'm going to eat it.
Okay. All right.
And
I was going to say, well, was this a family decision as an adult to go, you know, first, vegan to raw foodie?
Okay, well, first, I don't label myself by what I eat.
Okay.
So there's such a gray area in a person's diet that I find by labeling myself, I am strict vegan or I'm strict raw food, that you're kind of setting yourself up for disappointment.
Sure. Because this is a lifestyle for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And when someone says, I'm gonna do it, I'm going to go vegan, and then... And then they end up eating, I don't know, butter on their bread or something by accident. You know, they just, I've just ruined it. Now I'm not vegan anymore.
I might as well go back to, you know, Burger King.
Right. Yeah. And it wasn't a family decision, but the reason why I took this journey was because of health ailments and symptoms I was getting growing up just eating a typical North American diet.
Camille, that feeds into your question.
Yeah. I was just going to ask you, Karen, what's that moment, that pivotal moment that caused you to be vegan? So you're saying it was basically health?
Yeah, absolutely health driven.
Could you tell us more about that?
Was there one spark when you realized, or was it sort of a gradual thing?
The gradual part of it was going through the food elimination diets, trying to figure out if it was a food sensitivity, and then sort of realizing, coming to terms with the fact that it was probably processed sugar, because I had sugar in everything, and I always ate my dessert. And
how old were you when you started this process of elimination and the realization?
In my teens.
Really?
Yeah. You know, I didn't really pay close attention to it because I was a teenager. I was like, I got until I'm about 30. Then I really got to hunker down. It's like,
I had till I was about 30, and I still haven't hunkered down. And I am paying the price. Although I'm starting. I'm starting.
Well, you know, it's never too late to start because body heals itself. It really does. And a pivotal point, I suppose, would be when, I grew up with eczema. I've had it all my life, and I lived with it. But then I started to get more stomach aches in the morning. I would get really bad pains. So I decided to go to the doctor, and he said to me, you've got IBS. And I said, okay, well, now what do I do? He prescribed me some drugs. And I said, okay, well, then what? You know, I get off the medication, and then what? What if it comes back? Oh, well, some people go on it for life. And some people, you know, they can develop Crohn's disease. And that scared me.
Yeah.
I thought, I'm 20 and I'm not going to go on medication for life. This is absurd. My grandmother's 94. She's never been on medication in her life. So.
But your grandmother probably grew up in Canada not eating the tremendous amounts of processed foods.
That's right. Yeah. So we have to take a different path because we have to work within what we have. And we have some wonderful, wonderful improvements in our society as well. But you just have to sort of seek them out a little bit more, I guess.
Andrew, take the next question.
How easy was it for you to go down this path of becoming a raw foodie? I mean, it doesn't sound like a quick cold turkey because you went through the food eliminations, but what were the steps after you realized I've started to eliminate all these foods? What are the baby steps that you would say to the layman?
Yeah, exactly. So, so it's like you went through the gradual process of eliminating foods, but once you decided you were a raw foodie, did you ever go back?
Well, again, I don't define myself completely by what I eat.
Right.
So a lot of raw foodists will define a percentage, and I really don't know what my percentage is. It's high.
Okay.
And of course I have so many different stories to tell, but
tell them all.
But I don't know how to cook, so for me raw food was a great way for me to learn how to put food together. And then in doing so, I decided to warm those foods up. So I'm not gonna say, now I've just I've killed all the vitamins and nutrients, what's the point? But I'm not going to deny myself that either. If it's a cold day in Canada, I want to have a nice warm meal. So.
Yes.
I want that for you.
Yes. Thank you.
I'm going to insist.
So finding out that it was processed sugar in my diet, and deciding, okay, I have to get rid of this sugar. I couldn't do it cold turkey. I had to find a solution, but the solution was also not to wean myself down either. A solution was a complete substitution.
Ah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's not xylitol, and it's not, aspartame. We're getting closer, the dehydrated strawberries.
Oh, my God. By the way, I'm glad you brought it. Don't expect to go home with any.
Oh.
So what was the substitution?
The substitution is whole food.
That's truly
right, because the world has savory and sweet and bitter and sour and has everything natural. So you just have to utilize those natural whole foods to curb your cravings.
And your craving was
sugar.
Mm-hmm. And so what are the things, name some of the things that you substituted.
So now my substitution for processed sugar are dates, of course. Raw agave, maple syrup, which technically is not raw, but I'm also an ethical eater and a regional eater, so I try to consume the foods that grow naturally in my environment, which is maple syrup.
Yep.
Lucky me.
Yes. The maple leaf.
Yes.
Canada.
So I'll have those, and of course honey. Now honey, again, is something that many vegans will avoid eating. But
because it comes from an animal.
From an animal.
Fascinating.
But the problem is that some people may not know that bees, when there's ethical beekeeping, bees need to naturally pollinate to survive. So you're not hurting a bee by eating honey. You're helping the bees. They're pollinating. And honey does not have an expiration date. They found honey in the tombs in Egypt.
Edible. Stop it. She's truth telling. She's just truth telling.
Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah. But what do you think about raw honey? Should our listeners?
Raw
honey,
yeah.
Not the in the cute little bear. With he's so
little,
cute.
No bear honey.
Yeah. No bear honey.
Or the little bee, the cartoon bee.
Yeah.
Yes.
I used to eat that when I was a kid.
You know, it's interesting because I think this is, if you think about it, this is a point where vegans get a bad rap.
Yeah.
What do you mean you're not going to eat bee honey? Especially if they know that it's a byproduct. You're not actually eating a bee.
Mm-hmm.
And it's necessary for them. And so it's a food source that's there and readily available. It's sort of like they didn't make it for us, but they made it for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? That, so I think this is kind of where people go, oh, you're a vegan. It's like, and people think that you're kind of off track. You're mm-hmm. kind of nuts, mm-hmm. but they're not, but you're not, mm-hmm. you know, you're not, because you understand
balance
and the, you, and you've got the information and you act on the information in a very logical and wise way.
Yeah.
So you would call yourself just a balanced person.
Flexitarian.
Stop it. Okay, hang
I've
on.
I'm throwing names out all hang on. The place.
Hang on, I need a drink.
But Karen, with that said, and you've kind of touched on it, how easy is it for our listeners, if they would choose this type of lifestyle, how is it easy to stay a vegan or a raw foodie or even a vegetarian at this point? If we're talking about just baby steps,
vegetarian.
You know, tying into our animal friends, how did you kind of stay the course? How easy is it?
Rule number one, and people hear this all the time, read the ingredient list. If you can't understand it, then there's probably preservatives in it. Mm. I follow a personal rule of mine that I kind of made up. It's the no pee rule. So no packaging, no preservatives, no pesticides.
Oh.
Yeah.
No pee.
No pee.
Remember that. Listeners, remember that.
There's a fourth pee, too.
No packaging, no preservatives, no pesticides.
No processing.
That was it. Thank you.
It took all of us. Let me ask you, when was the last time you wanted a burger?
I don't remember, to be honest.
Really?
Yeah, and it's funny because, you know, most burger places now will offer a vegetarian option. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That, to me, is a treat, not because necessarily of the vegan, the vegetarian patty or the vegan patty, but because of the bread.
Yeah.
You're married.
Yes.
Let's talk about your husband.
Okay.
Okay. What's his name?
His name is Einar. Einar Hoiko Jørgensen.
Wow. Hang on. I need And another strawberry. Einar?
Yes.
Say it again.
Einar.
Yeah.
Last name.
Hoiker Johannesson. Hoiker is his middle name.
Hoiker Johannesson.
Yeah.
Einar Hoiker Johannesson?
Yes.
There you go. Where does he hail from?
I'm going to Iceland.
From Iceland. That's right. Yeah.
So let's talk about his eating habits. Yes. And do they mesh? Are they yours? Is he? Because I had a friend once who was so vegan. And her husband was meat and potatoes.
Mm. Yep.
Two separate sets of spoons. And she was off at Thanksgiving when she had like her family of, you know, 18,000 brothers. And they cooked, they hacked. I mean, they were like Vikings. They hacked into that turkey. And she would have to be with a little bowl of quinoa. But she had to cook for her husband.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So, and again, gravy and the whole thing. Wow. Let's talk about Einar.
I am so lucky because he's just happy to be fed. he's terrific.
He doesn't much mind what it is.
No, we don't have meat in the house. We don't. We don't have any animal byproducts in the house except honey. Mm-hmm. If he wants to have meat, then he'll either do takeaway or purchase some meat at the butcher and put it in his little grill. But it doesn't
outside in the backyard, the corner.
No, you know, I've definitely created a lot of awareness for him, especially coming from the north, where it's normal dietary.
It's
a normal practice to have meat and potatoes because that's the natural food available to them. They don't have avocado trees and banana trees, but they do actually have greenhouses, so they're growing bananas.
That's how we can grow quinoa here.
Mm-hmm.
Right, right.
So, I mean, when we first met, I told him, well, I primarily eat non-processed food, and he looked at me a little strange, didn't understand, as most people don't, and I said, well, whole foods and I don't eat anything packaged from the grocery store, and he was very open and receptive to learning about this, and that's what I love about him is that he won't just shut anything out. He'll sort of analyze it and see the pros and cons, and he understands it. And
And you would say that his dietary are slowly changing?
Oh no, he's improved. Improved. He's changed his diet.
How long have you been married?
We're just coming up on 2 years.
Ah.
Oh, the newlyweds.
Yeah. Can you share? You have something in a little box down here.
Uh-huh.
What's in the little box?
Yeah. Oh, it's a special dessert that I made for you.
For me?
Yes. And
are you going to share
No. There's no backtracking. I want you both to hear that she made it for me.
She made it for you.
Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes.
Okay. Can you actually just pass it over there?
I'm going to show it on camera. I can get the spoon now.
Maybe during the break.
Okay. Yeah,
okay.
I'll do that.
This looks
amazing.
Yeah.
It really does.
So, okay.
It looks so yummy.
Now, it would probably actually taste even more yummy if peaches were in season.
Okay.
So I did a little improvisation when I went to the grocery store. I went to, what's that place called?
Fresh and Easy.
Okay.
Fresh and Easy.
And I picked up some fresh blueberries and peaches. Everything in this, it's a peach blueberry cobbler.
Oh.
And it's raw.
Okay.
So.
Wait, I want to hear about this.
I want to hear about it. I was going to ask you to give us one of your favorite vegan recipes. And it's sitting on the table. So tell us about it.
Okay. This was one of the first recipes that I ever learned when I started researching about raw foods and raw desserts. I found on the internet the Toronto Vegetarian Association, TVA, and they were doing a workshop with Chef Doug McNish. And
who we're going to talk about a little bit later.
He's one of my inspirations. And this was one of the recipes that he showed in his demo. And we all got a little sample of it. And I went right home and I bought my ingredients and I made it.
Wow. Mm-hmm. You know, when I destroy the garage that's on the property because it's falling down in a heap, and then I build a new garage, and then I build the room on top on my property, yay! Oh. I'm going to make it a test kitchen. And
well,
I'm,
that's smart.
And if I can do it, I'm going to make it a vegan raw food test kitchen.
Nice. I can tell you how to start that.
Okay. Oh, all no, right. You're going to come down and you're going to design it. That's number one. Okay. So, cobbler.
Yes.
Then tell me how you made it.
So the ingredients from off the top of my head, walnuts, coconut oil, raw virgin, peaches, blueberries, cinnamon, sea salt, and and a little bit of agave, and I think that is it.
Mm. Wow. It looks like some
flaxseed.
There's some sort of something, some sort of crumbly on top.
Yeah, that's the walnuts and the flaxseed and cinnamon.
Oh, wow.
And dates.
Oh, that's right.
Carolyn, do you think you could just share like a half?
No.
I'll bring you a spoon, Camille, and you'll just hold it.
Okay.
Just look at it.
I can't. But here's the interesting thing. It also says, how much time did it take to make this?
I took a look at the time and it took me 14 minutes or something, 13 mm-hmm. minutes.
Wow,
it was less than 15.
Okay. And you could probably put other fruit in there, like you said, fruit that's in season,
yeah,
right?
So I put nectarines in here, not peaches.
Oh okay. My gosh, if you guys think you're getting any of it, you're so wrong. But the bottom line is that it's easy. It's probably very inexpensive too.
Yeah, it's Whole Foods, so it depends. Nuts and seeds don't tend. Well, it's cheaper here.
It is cheaper. Yes, yes.
It's cheaper here.
Yeah.
Not only that, but you can buy in bulk, and then you just have it. Have it.
So.
And what about? So I'm just playing the devil's advocate here with some of our listeners that maybe just can't put this much energy into it as raw foodies. But if we want to keep vegan, they could get fresh frozen, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they could substitute a few things mm-hmm. to kind of make their own if it is more of an economic.
Right.
Yeah. Economic issue with them.
Are you referring to the fruits?
The fruits, yes. You know, the nut. I mean, nuts.
We can buy in bulk. Mm-hmm. You know, we can buy. I guess you could go to Costco. You've got to find. You could go to Costco and get like pecans mm-hmm. and walnuts. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. So there's that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, there's always another tier. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got, and you want to have raw nuts. And then the next level is organic raw nuts. And then the next level is. Soak your nuts and sprout your nuts to make them live because, you know, a lot of raw foodies, they eat primarily live whole foods.
Okay, let's just go over this. Mm-hmm. You take a pecan and you soak it in
water.
For how long?
Every type of nut has sort of a different length of time. Almonds take about 24 hours to soak, and you change the water every few hours.
And then you sprout it.
Well, see, what happens is it becomes
live. Because I'm thinking
of
like a little green thing comes out.
Yes, and absolutely, that can happen.
Oh.
And so you've heard of like alfalfa sprouts, and broccoli sprouts, pea shoot sprouts. That's actually got, I don't know how many more times the nutrients than the whole large original vegetable. So, for example, broccoli sprouts have way more concentrated nutrients in it than broccoli itself.
Who knew?
Huh.
I'm actually, and look at vegan extraordinaire. Okay, so you go to Costco, you buy the big thing of almonds or pecans or walnuts, mm-hmm. and you soak them.
Yeah. Now, they won't necessarily sprout.
Okay, I was going
to
say.
Because the sprouting is a whole different, you know, it's a different step. Like, you have to remove the water, and then they stay damp and moist, and then they start to sprout. But then you have to be careful about fermentation. You don't want them to go rancid. Okay. So that's a whole different thing.
You know
thing.
What, listeners,
you
don't do that.
Don't sprout it. Don't
do that.
Just raw. Just buy raw.
Buy raw.
Not yet.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah.
Get yourselves acclimated to raw, and then you can Google how to sprout your walnut.
And can I just say one more thing here, because it's off the top of my head. For the listeners, I mean, your skin is
it's
luminous.
Glowing.
And I'm just thinking, you eat raw, you eat these nutrient-rich foods, your body on the outside is going to show it. So listeners, if you want beautiful hair and skin, I mean,
and
look at Karen.
We talked a little bit about, before we came on the air, about apple cider vinegar.
Yes.
So we're going to get to that in a little bit, too. But that is one of your skin regimens. That's mm-hmm. part of it. Where do you get your apple cider? I guess you can get as apple cider vinegar is just apple
Bragg's.
Cider vinegar.
I like Bragg's.
Bragg's.
All right.
Listeners, we're going to take a break. We're going to come back. And while we take a break, while they all enjoy or try to enjoy my cobbler, I'm going to ask a trivia question, which we haven't asked in a while. I may need to put my glasses on for this. And remember, the whoever comes into the chat room with the correct answer first gets a jar of Coragem. Treatment for animal skin, if there's ever a wound on the skin. As also treatment for human skin. You get a copy of Gray Stafford's book, Zoomility. And you get a Kong toy. Ooh. Kong. All right. Trivia question. I'm just, I don't even understand how I'm still on the air.
You need some cobbler, Karen.
I need, yeah.
you
need cobbler.
You know what? I'm going to go get you a spoon.
You go get
I'm
me
going
spoon?
To a spoon.
You know what? I'm Come being out. Very generous. Get a few.
Yay!
But I will be actually dishing out the trivia. I mean, the quote, kit. Yeah, there you go. We've had better shows. Not necessarily better shows, but shows where I've enunciated
it's
better.
Okay. We all understand. We're all
Do
here.
You?
Yes, okay. I understand you.
The name white rhino actually derives from the Dutch word for... Okay. Look it up. The name white rhino actually derives from the Dutch word for... There you go, listeners. That's the trivia question. Whoever chimes in on the chat room first. Oh, look, someone's actually... You can't. But I'll give you a card. Karen's actually...
Googling it.
So, come on in. Come on in, chat room listeners. Give me your answer. Google it. There we go. All right. Now, wait a minute. You can't Google it because we're actually back now.
I could show you my sheet. I have the answer right here.
If you get
that cobbler for me.
There's no getting the cobbler. What is with the cobbler? Listen, it's just a bunch of flaxseed. All right. And we're back. Karen Wallington. It was a short little break. We actually never went off the air.
Nope.
Yeah. Short break. Karen Wallington. Raw food champ. Raw foodie. All right. So let's get a little dire now. Just a little bit. We're gonna talk about factory farming, your views on factory farming, and how we can improve. Camille, you have thoughts on this too. How we can improve conditions for animals and therefore conditions for people.
Oh, yeah, I mean, Karen, and you, I would assume you'd be aware of this and some of the conditions with our animal friends, cows, pigs, turkeys, chickens primarily. They live in horrific conditions. They live in factory farms, which is exactly what that sounds like, listeners. They're put into tiny crates. Dairy farms, the cows are kept impregnated when they birth their calf. Their calf is taken away from them, put in usually to a veal crate. Chickens are in these tiny wire cages, stuffed in these airless rooms. I mean, I could go on and on, but I won't. We're aware of these things, and how do you think we can start to, A, educate the public about this, and what can we look for when we go to the grocery store for those meat eaters out there that aren't ready to go vegetarian or vegan or raw? How can we educate them what to look for? Looking at labels, being aware of just the plight of the animal and really spinning it back on their health. If they're eating an animal that is injected with hormones or an animal that has been on a factory farm and hasn't been treated well, energetically or just health-wise, they're really eating
that fear. They're eating those hormones.
Yes, injected with hormones, but also the hormones that they secrete when they are going up into the abattoir.
Yeah.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, I never learned to cook. So
I'm fascinated. Your grandmother cooked, though, didn't she?
She did.
Yeah. All right. Grandma.
Grandma.
So
why didn't you ever learn to cook?
My mom cooked for the purpose of feeding the kids, and my brother and I didn't like the same food. My dad didn't like the same food, so we had this limited amount of food that she would make and that we all agreed upon. And I grew up in the 80s, right? It was a microwave.
TV dinners, that kind of thing.
Yeah. So.
And you also came to this realization in your teens. Mm-hmm. So a lot of women, you know, have to learn to cook to feed their husbands, which, you know, and so you missed that step because you were already a raw foodie before you got married.
Yes. Yeah. And, and experimenting with making foods, because I don't like to say cooking foods, although I've learned to cook my raw foods, which is kind of exciting. In fact, actually, my husband's brother taught me how to make stir fry, the order of operation, the order of the vegetables. But going back to the meat, you know, I never cooked meat. I never cooked. So I wouldn't know in terms of looking on a package to say, oh, this farm or, oh, this this country. I mean, logically, it's like if it's coming from far, far away, then that's even worse.
Yeah. Because their standards, even though our standards in terms of factory farming and caging and are ridiculous, but theirs are even worse.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. It depends.
Many countries.
Yeah. So, you know, if you really want to make a conscious effort, I would say take a photo with your smartphone and look at, you know, the ingredients and then look them up. Or go to a local butcher, for sure. Yeah, as long as you sort of know where your meat is coming from, if you can ask your friends, well, hey, do you know any local farms or any places? Where do you get your meat from? Right? Just talk to people.
So because they are out there.
Yeah.
They are out there. And there's the book, you might be familiar with it, Forks Over Knives.
Yes.
And
the documentary.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And that, I know our listeners, if you're interested, can pick up a copy of that and really read and watch the documentary and be more educated on, yes, like you said, if you are a meat eater, how to responsibly eat meat, dairy, eggs. Exactly. That I know that certified humane label, which Carolyn, I can give you that because I have a little sheet maybe we can post on the website.
Fantastic.
Of if you are a meat eater, these are the labels. These are the farms that treat their animals well.
And at the end of the day, you know, because I don't label myself by what I eat, I don't beat myself up, right? I don't cook it in the house, I don't make it in the house, but if I'm out and I have options at a restaurant, I'm not going to go for the steak. I haven't had steak in years. And I'm not going to go for chicken now. I do like fish, but fish is very difficult to eat because there's so many factory fish farming out there.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
I feel bad about it.
Yes, you're not consuming ethically.
Yeah.
Do you teach?
No.
Why not?
Because the opportunity hasn't presented itself so far.
Canada. Toronto. You should. Have you ever spoken with someone and they come back to you and say, you've changed my life. I'm eating. I mean, have you ever had a success story?
I've had clients. I mean, it's great because I'm a hairstylist. So my clients are sitting in my chair for a few hours and they have to listen to me. Nowhere to go. But I in turn listen to their tales of whatever is going on in their lives. And I've had many clients inquiring about my raw food and desserts and, oh, what did you make this time? And what, you
By
know.
The way, spectacular.
Oh, you did? You tried it. Good.
I tried it while Camille was talking about
I think the nectarines are a little underripe because, again, it's not seasoned.
Really don't care.
It's okay.
I really don't care. But while I was eating it while you were talking about the caging and the and I was like
well, I'm sorry.
Okay. But there's nothing in there that hurt any animal.
No,
so.
No,
we got
no.
To pass it down.
You're sharing. She's sharing.
I gave you a spoon.
Thank you.
There's your spoon right over there.
Oh, yay. I love that spoon.
Yeah.
Where's your spoon? That
is so I just sent Carolyn's spoon down.
That is so incredible.
Oh, my
We're
gosh.
We're all family.
This looks amazing.
It's so incredibly good. I am losing my mind.
And you have this protein with the walnuts, and walnuts have omega-3s in them,
That's
right?
Oh,
very
really
good fatty
good
oil.
Yeah.
And the flaxseed.
Yes.
Oh my!
I know.
Lord.
Yes. I know.
Jamal, do you want to get in on this?
Jamal, he's shaking. Yes.
Wow, that is spectacular.
Let's talk about some of the people that influenced you.
Absolutely.
Influenced you. Doug McNish.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about him.
He's a chef, a classically trained chef who turned vegan, and he speaks openly about vegan food and veganism. He runs a restaurant now called Open Kitchen in Toronto, and it's wonderful. I love it. So I saw him do a demonstration in Toronto with the TVA, and he showed the cobbler and a lime pudding and a Greek black kale salad. And then we got the ingredient list. We got the recipes. So I went home and eagerly tried all three of them. So yeah.
I could live on that.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. It's so good.
I for could breakfast. Live on that. Mm-hmm. I could mm-hmm. have that for breakfast.
And that's, well, you absolutely can. You can have dessert for breakfast. And
why not? Very often I've been known to eat a pie at 8 o'clock in the morning. Kidding.
Well, I can certainly tell you how to make a raw pie. It's no problem.
Raw pie.
And that was really how I got off the processed sugar was raw desserts. That was my turning point.
Okay. Sugar for you. Fascinating. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then again, you know, I don't eat yogurt. It's processed. And there's sugar mm-hmm. and there's dairy, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm.
Tell us about Miliana.
Yes. Miliana, I met her through a raw food community.
How does she pronounce her last name? Yeah.
I know. Mijan.
Mlajan.
Mijan.
Mlajan.
Sounds pretty.
Miliana.
Yes.
Yeah.
Another one of your influences. And then we're going to talk about maybe some books that you can recommend.
Okay. So I met Miliana through the raw food community. And I was actually, my grandmother had a 60-year-old apple tree in her backyard before she moved from the house that she lived in for that length of time.
Wow.
And the last few years, she hadn't been pruning her tree. And I said, Grandma, we've got all these apples. We have to do something with them. We have to give them to people. So I put it on the community. I'm like, bins. I had 5 bins about 4 feet tall filled with these Macintosh apples, which my friend here in California says you guys don't really get Macs.
We don't get Macs.
No.
So this, yeah, Miliana, she messaged me and said, I'll take them. I'll take a whole bunch of them. So she came over and she says, here, I didn't bring much, but these are raw crackers that I make.
Like flaxseed or sesame seed crackers, that kind of thing.
Beyond that.
Foolish child. Foolish me.
All kinds of wonderful nuts and seeds and spices, and it's delicious. So she makes like 5 or 6, 8 kinds of crackers, and she names them all after famous artists like Van Gogh and Matisse. And it's really adorable because she's also an artist. So I became addicted to her raw foods, and she made crackers, brownies, truffles, pies, and dips and spreads.
Oh my God!
Are we eating after this? Where are we going for lunch?
We're gonna meals like daily,
or Denny's.
No,
close. No.
I don't remember the last time I've eaten at a Denny's.
We do. God bless.
Yay, but Denny's. See, that's the thing, right? Mm. So, okay, a vegan will go to Denny's.
What do you
do? Because a vegan can eat bread. A vegan will eat
pancakes.
Yep. Absolutely.
But aren't eggs in pancakes?
Huh?
Don't you put eggs in pancakes and milk?
Sometimes on batters. I just remember, I guess it was about a year ago, Denny's had their bacon fest.
Oh yeah.
It was bacon and everything.
Everything.
Everything
had bacon.
Hideous.
It was crazy.
Hideous.
I make eggplant bacon.
What? Okay, you know. And how long are you in town?
Yeah, well, it's, again, steps to the kitchen, right?
Well, no, wait a minute. Let's talk about a cookbook.
Mm-hmm. Which one?
You.
Yours. Yeah,
you
starting
writing
with the cobbler.
Oh. No, that's Doug's.
Doug's recipe.
Thank you, Doug.
Yes. Okay, then let's talk about some of the concoctions you have created. What's the best thing that you have come up with?
Well, the thing is that I'll take inspiration from the people that inspire me, and then I'll substitute, I'll swap out ingredients.
Right.
And I never really measure. So that's the biggest problem you know, is people are like, well, what's the recipe? I'm like, I don't know. It's never the same twice. I generally have an idea, you know, ratios of ingredients. and components. So a lot of the, you know, a lot of the foods will be like, say, my one of my favorites is cheesecake. And yes, raw cheesecake.
A raw cheesecake.
No dairy. No sugar.
I think that's one of the ones.
No processed cane sugar.
I think we've actually got that recipe from you.
But do you?
Yeah, well, I think we do.
Maybe.
And I think it's going to go up on the website very shortly. But I'm fascinated.
So there's different flavors you can make. You can make orange cheesecake. You can make chocolate cheesecake.
And what's your base with that?
Yeah. Cashews.
Cashews.
All about the cashew.
Raw cashews.
Absolutely.
Guess what? I know where to get them in bulk.
Can I import those to Canada?
Maybe we'll send you some. Yay. What do you think about them?
I like
what
that.
What do you think
idea.
About them, Macintosh?
Yes.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
And I get really excited about talking about raw food. I really do. It's
well, because it's. I think if I'm, it's first of all, it's keeping yourself in balance. Mm-hmm. It's keeping yourself healthy. I would venture to say there's no eczema. There's no digestive problems.
Nope.
None. Your skin is flawless. And again, coming back to the core meaning of this show, we are saving animals. It's one person at a time.
Yeah.
And that's what it is, because these great government shows of ivory destruction and this kind of thing, I personally think they're doing nothing but upping the desire for ivory. And so upping the desire for poaching, and we've got to stop eating. We've got to stop eating meat. We've got to stop doing, we've got to start thinking ethically. Mm-hmm. Ethically. Not just for the planet, but for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it just happens that the planet's going to benefit.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
I say equal weight to both.
Right. We spin it. On the health side, people's health. Mm-hmm. I mean, if your child is sick, if your significant other is sick, even if you don't care at all about the animal, if you look at your family and your friends, mm-hmm. and you want them mm-hmm. to be well. I recently told a friend, how could you give your 8-year-old granddaughter McDonald's? Do you know what you're feeding them? You're feeding them washed, bleached meat, which probably has eyeballs and fecal matter in it. Yes. I mean, it's that
do you
public
think you,
consciousness of health.
Do you
health.
Think you made a difference with that one?
I'm not sure. I have to. I'm from a small town in Ohio, and when I go back, I try not to get preachy, but I try to be, you know, educate. Sure. So we'll see. But it is one step at a time, like you said, one person at a time.
Yeah. I almost want this show to be preachy in a way. I'm of two minds. I want it to be very accessible, mm-hmm. but for people to understand the import, and it's time sensitive. Mm-hmm. It's now becoming time sensitive with approaching 8 billion people on the planet, soon mm-hmm. to be 9.
Well, you know, in 2010, the UN had put out an article that I sent both of you last night, Andrew and Carolyn, and Karen, you might know this.
And we're going to post it on the website.
Saying that climate change, we're with these cattle farms. I mean, again, it's for the health of the world. It's not, it is about the animals to us, but if you don't take that platform, it's for the very...
It's for Earth.
It's for Earth.
It's for Earth and us. Because you know what? This species, this planet's going to be fine. Planet is going to be fine. We are screwed.
And well, I just believe in balance. And you know, when if nobody on the entire planet ate an animal ever again, we would be so juxtaposition. We'd be so. Yeah. Opposite and having other problems, like there would be a shortage of certain types of fruits and vegetables and grains. Mm-hmm. And look at like corn. Corn's not a food, and like I don't even want to talk about the what corn can do for the world, mm-hmm. and what we're using it for versus what we're using it for.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So much more to talk about. I am finally today going to read we're going to have a hero of the show today.
We are.
We're going to have a hero of the show, and we have gone so over in so many of our other shows that I haven't had time to read it. But we are having you back on again in just in several shows. It'll be a couple of months. So I'm very excited about. We will continue this conversation. Thank you so much for being on the show. We have all of Karen's website links and Twitter handles and Facebook page. So please, please, please contact her. Contact her for anything. Contact her and say, you made a difference, Karen. Aww. That's really what I want to hear. So here we go. The hero of the show. I may actually have to put my glasses on. Because
this is a good one.
It's a very good one.
Yep.
Because I've been aware of this man, Cleveland Amory, for many, many years. But I think my listeners need to know about him and exactly what he did and why he is so significant. Cleveland Amory. Look him up. even after I'm done. Look him up. He was born in 1917 into a family with a history of animal advocacy. So much so that one could say Amory's connection to animals was built into his DNA. He was a Harvard graduate, a literary giant, World War II vet, and the youngest editor of the Saturday Evening Post at the age of 22. In 1974, his pioneering work, Mankind, Our Incredible War on Wildlife, was one of his first forays into the advocacy movement. It was a sharp indictment of hunting and animal wildlife management. Amory became a serious animal rights advocate after witnessing a bullfight in Nogales, Mexico, which literally changed his life and moved him to walk away from his existing literary career into a whole new calling, which he referred to as his real work. Story has it that at the end of the bullfight he saw, after the matador had cut off the animal's ears and held them above his head in a gesture of victory, Amory leaped out of his seat, marched to the stadium floor, and knocked the matador over face forward onto the ground. Amory then plunged headfirst into the deep end of animal rights causes, vivisection, the use of animals for medical, cosmetic, and consumer research in an effort to educate people about what was going on in the hidden world of animal experimentation. He cited many experiments he witnessed, which I cannot retell here because they are simply too horrifying. His exposés alerted the public to what was going on in labs all over the world. One woman wrote the Saturday Review and said, "He will probably be assassinated, but he will perish in a good cause." Also in 1963, Amory became aware of an event called the Sticks and Stones Hunt, or the Bunny Bop, in Harmony, North Carolina, every December. The Bunny Bop was a prize-winning contest sponsored by the local American Legion Hall, and listeners, please Google it, because it's too horrible to describe on air. Though he lost many friends in the course of his life due to his commitment to the animal protection cause, Amory was instrumental in Congress's passage of the Animal Welfare Act of 1966. The list of organizations he joined is damn near endless, and Amory made the strongest contribution to the animal movement with the founding of the Fund for Animals in 1967 with the motto, "We speak for those who can't." In 1979, Amory founded the Black Beauty Ranch, an 80-acre sanctuary in Texas, as a final refuge for hundreds of mistreated and unwanted animals. He died at the ranch in 2002. One source lists it as 1998. Today, the ranch encompasses approximately 13,050 acres. I'm sorry, that was 1,350 100, acres. Yes. It's like the 600 tons of ivory that was crushed. Where animals are unfettered and free to roam the grounds. The words on the ranch's gate were taken from Anna Sewell's novel, I Have Nothing to Fear, and my story ends. My troubles are all over, and I am at home. It was a ranch of dreams. Listeners, we will have the link to a more complete bio of Cleveland Amory on the Animal Magnetism website. I encourage you to read more about this incredibly amazing man, because he walked away from a literary career. He was huge. He was a literary giant. Like, you know, like Bennett Cerf. He was, I mean, my God, he was astonishing. And he just walked away to help animals. Mm. I'm probably going to paraphrase. I'm not quoting it directly. But a country is known by the way it treats its animals. Mm-hmm. And we're failing. Cleveland Amory tried to staunch the flow a little bit. So I encourage you listeners to read about him. We are at the end of another Animal Magnetism installment. Thank you so much, Karen Wallington, for coming and educating us and bringing us treats. And really, I think, in very, very not simplistic, but accessible terms, educating my listeners as to exactly why we all need to at least take those baby steps towards becoming vegan, a raw foodie, towards why we should stop eating animals, animal products, animal byproducts. So I cannot thank you enough, and we'll talk to you again. Okay?
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Had a great time.
Good. I'm glad, because you're not done. You're never going to get rid of us. With that, we come to the end of another installment. I want to thank my co-hosts, Miss Camille Lacotte, who is also our contributing correspondent for the Carolyn Hennessy's Animal Magnetism Facebook page, and our resident healthy balanced eater.
Yes.
Yay. And Miss Andrea Compton, who also pulls double duty as my producer and who basically runs my life. And to Jamal, one of the two handsomest men That's right. You're nodding. Yep. See, you're nodding. Yeah. You need a camera on you, don't you? One of the two handsomest men in radio. And Tony Sweet, my producer. My executive producer is also the other handsomest man. We need to get cameras on both of you. Remember, listeners, in everything you do, every action you take, please try to remember the animals and cultivate the preservationist heart. Back in 2 weeks. See you then.
Something tells me it's all happening at the zoo. I do believe it. I do believe it's true. The monkeys stand for honesty, giraffes are insincere, and the elephants are kindly, but they're dumb. Orangutans are skeptical of changes in their cages, and the zookeeper is very fond of rum. Zebras are reactionaries, antelopes are missionaries.
Welcome to the new sound of online radio. Welcome to the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network. 'Cause you make me feel like I've been locked out.